Father in heaven, I thank you so much for your presence, for the comforting presence of love, of truth. And now, Lord, as we bow our heads once more and prepare to eat your word, we pray, Lord, that you would give us teeth that can chew and understand, a mind that can process and really be nourished by what you're going to say. Lord, I pray that you would, in a mighty way, speak to the individual needs in this room. With the one word, touch every life and every experience, whether here or online. And please give us that Sabbath day blessing you've promised. Hide me in your cross. May your people not hear or see. None of me, but all of you, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, you probably know this by now, but we are living in unprecedented times, are we not? And unprecedented times require unprecedented faith. We have to live our lives in response to what the world presents us. Many people would say that we're living in a time period in universal history, not just world history, but in universal history that is the most difficult and the most heightened that we've ever seen or that anyone's ever seen. And the reality is this is true, but to the same token, there is a tremendous blessing of being alive and being alive right now during the present day. Never take what God has given you for granted. We are, and if you are under the sound of my voice, you must understand that you are a blessed individual. You are blessed to see what you're seeing, to hear what you're hearing. And I'll share with you why that is. I've entitled today's study, Called, Chosen, and Faithful. If you go with me in your Bibles to Revelation chapter 17, the 17th chapter of the book of Revelation is a very interesting one because it is the response by the angel who had the vial of God. John in Revelation chapter 15 saw angels with the vials of God. The Bible says, for in them were the wrath of God, the plagues, of course. And John obviously is in vision on the island of Patmos, and God is revealing to him the last disciple who they couldn't kill even when they tried to boil him in oil, a cauldron of oil. God reserved this disciple so he could give this message to us. And John is there and he's seeing things that are shocking to him. But in Revelation chapter 17, something very interesting happens because the angel that's of late sharing with John comes to John and says in verse 1, he says, come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. Of course, John had seen that beast rise up out of the sea. He saw that in Revelation chapter 13. He had seen in Revelation chapter 12, he saw the bride, the purity of God's church. He saw the triumph of the church in Revelation chapter 14, of course. And now we're here, and God is going to unpack for us this final thrust against God's people. And he's revealing to John and to us what that looks like. And right in the heart of explaining who this beast power is, giving very descriptive language in Revelation chapter 17, many of these verses you are very familiar with. Babylon, mystery Babylon, the great, the abominations of the earth, the daughters of Babylon. We teach these things, but right in the heart of revealing to John this final crisis, notice this verse in verse 14. These powers, these kings. And of course, if you've never read this chapter, specifically in verse 12, who we're talking about in verse 14 are the 10 horns in verse 12. In verse 12, we're told, and the 10 horns which thou sawest are 10 kings which have received no kingdom as yet. This is a future experience, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. Apparently, the world will be divided, at least in their authority and power, into 10 regions or 10 sections. 10 also in the Bible represents completion. And so the whole world will stand opposed in conjunction and alignment with the beast to oppose who? Well, it says here in verse 13, they have one mind and they shall give their power. That word power is the same word that we see in John chapter 1, where it says, to as many as received him, to them he gave power or authority. They have authority. They give their authority and their strength to the beast. And so now that the whole world seems united, not together with Christ, but opposed in opposition to Christ. Notice verse 14. These powers, this beast, these shall make what with the saints? Make war with the Lamb. With the Lamb. And the Lamb shall, and this is a beautiful verse, brothers and sisters, because, you know, while we're in the race, sometimes it's hard to think about the crown, isn't it? But we must think about the crown. In fact, it was the crown laid up for Christ. And that crown, by the way, is not a physical object. The crown, we're told in the book of Micah, when we think about the garland that we're going to have, when we think about that reward, when Jesus said, lay up your treasure in heaven, that treasure are souls. And for Jesus, when Jesus looked ahead, he saw you and he saw me there in the Garden of Gethsemane. He saw us walking in robes of white. He saw our little children, if they may, use their little wings to fly. He saw us there. He saw the joy we would have. And that, for the joy that was before him, he endured the cross. Here, we're told that they make war with the Lamb. But it says here, they shall be overcome. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We're standing right now in the heat of the final crisis, and it's swelling on us. But you have to understand, as we look at today's subject, look at your trial, look at what is to come through this lens, that the battle has been won. Amen. The battle has been won. It's yours. Jesus conquered for us. And I love how John finishes this out. He overcomes them, those kings, those horns. And it says here, for he is Lord of lords, King of kings, little k, little l, Lord of lords, King of kings. And they that are with him, they that are what? They that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. It's one important note that as we look at the translation in Revelation chapter 17, verse 14, another way that we can translate this, in fact, in many Bibles, it's actually translated this way, and they that overcome with him. They that overcome with him are called and chosen and faithful. You are not just a regular person. There is a reason why God called you out of darkness into the marvelous light for this time. God has prepared a special people for a special time to give a special message with a special result. Amen. And I want you to know that you're not only called, you're chosen. And you're not only chosen, but you can be faithful. See, that's your part. Let's look at it today. Let's look at this through the lens of the experience of the seventh church. We know that this verse would have to apply to a specific people. Why? Because it's stuck right in the midst of Earth's final crisis. So it doesn't apply to the first or second or third or the fifth or sixth church. It applies to the seventh church, otherwise known as Laodicea. We call them the remnant of God, the commandment keepers of God. We call them those who have the testimony of Jesus, the faith of Jesus. So we're talking to a people specifically that this message applies to, this text applies to. And I will say this last thing, and that is, once we really understand this message, we will really understand who called, chosen, and faithful. We will really understand why they are called, chosen, and faithful. Why? Lord, because I want to be a part of this group, and I believe you do too. I don't want to just be here at church, just hearing about what is good and and then not having a victory in my life. I want to be called chosen and faithful. Primarily, I want to be faithful to God. But these people figured it out. They, in their lives, in their experience, through their failures and their victories, came to a point where they could be called faithful, full of faith. That's what I want. This message is critical for us because I will tell you, when Jesus comes, what is he looking for? He's looking for faith. That's the thing that he's coming for. He's looking for those who can trust him and whom he can trust. Lord, show us how to move beyond an emotional experience, how to move beyond just professing what we don't possess. We want to have the type of faith in Jesus that makes our life look different than anybody else around us. God wants to do something in us today. He wants to do something in his church that causes them to stand out, not in pride, but stand out in a way that causes the world to say, God lives. God is real. And I'm asking you, as we look at this, please, please pray that God will reveal something to you that will inspire you to take the next step, to make the next decision, to resist just a little bit more, to be a little bit more firm in your conviction. Pray that God will come into your life and do something that he's never done before. And you know, it's not so, this is not a play on words. You don't have to say, because you know, you oftentimes will hear people say, well, ask God to do something he's never done before. We're told that when we get to the kingdom, every day we will be happier and happier and happier. You know why that's possible? Because every single day God will reveal more and more of himself to us. And everything we learn about God, everything we know about God, and as we grow in knowledge of him, our joy will swell every single day. There will never be a day in heaven where you look back and say, I was happier. Like in this planet, on this world, in this life, sometimes you can look back and say, 2 weeks ago, I was happier than I am today. Mm-hmm. It's not the case in heaven. In heaven, there will never be a time when you can look behind you and say, yesterday was better than today. No, the day you're standing in will be the best day of your life. Because you will have learned more about the love of God, and he will have revealed more of that love to you. So don't tell me God can't today say, you can't ask God, do something in my life you've never done before. That's exactly what God wants to do. He wants to do something he's never done before. Don't waste the opportunity by unbelief or through unbelief, not expecting God to do that for you. You are called, you are chosen, and you can be faithful. Who are the called? Go with me in your Bibles to Romans chapter 1. Says they that are with him. We're going to go to Romans chapter 1. The word call is in the Greek G2 822, and it means, it's kletos, and it's used two ways. We're going to Romans chapter 1. It's used two ways. It's meant as a discharge of office. For example, David is called to the role of an elder. That's a discharge of, to discharge an office, a divinely appointed or selected position. It's meant that way. He's been called. But it's also used in another way. It's used to mean an invitation. In fact, even as to a banquet. And so I figured I wanted to show you the both ways that it's used. So you would understand. If we go to Romans chapter 1, Paul in the first chapter uses the word called both ways, kletos, 11 times in the New Testament. It says here in verse 1, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be in a what? Called to be an apostle, divinely appointed, divinely selected to be an apostle. In fact, God came to Paul, formerly Saul, and called him, definite, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. If we keep going, notice in verse 5. In verse 5, then again, excuse me, in verse 6 and 7, he uses the word kletos in the other way that it's used in the New Testament. Let's pick up in verse 5. It says, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations, for his name, among whom all are ye also the called of Jesus Christ to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be what? Called to be saints. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. You've been invited to be what? A saint. Revelation chapter 17, interestingly, verse 14, both of those definitions apply. First, the end time church in Revelation chapter 17, verse 14, are divinely appointed to proclaim the imminent return of Christ Jesus. They're divinely appointed to announce the judgment hour message to the world. They're divinely appointed to call brethren out of Babylon, out of confusion, and to worship the God that created the heaven and the earth, the sea. They are divinely appointed to expose the Antichrist, to expose the darkness of this world, and to warn people from receiving the mark. Divinely appointed to vindicate God's character. Divinely appointed to do this during earth's final crisis. So we do have a specific call, a specific divine appointment. In fact, to no other generation has God given the task and the honor. The final revelation of God's love is a demonstration of his character of love. And God says, I'm going to move out of the most holy place, and I'm going to let that demonstration be on full display without forgiving grace available, only empowering grace available. But I'm going to let you demonstrate who I am to a fallen world. The 144,000 who stand with Christ through earth's final crisis will have the Father's name written in their forehead. They are called to live the life of Jesus in answer to the charge of Satan that it's not possible for a fallen human being to answer that charge, which is to live an obedient life like Christ. So yes, we've been called or divinely appointed. Yes, that definition applies. We've been called to that appointment as a people, as individuals. But the remnant church has also been called or invited, the other kletos, the way that it's used in Scripture. We've been invited. Now, the question is, Bible study, to what have we been invited? To what have we been invited? Go with me to Matthew chapter 22. And let's look at this clearly. Matthew 22, what have we been invited to? Matthew 22 gives us an idea clearly in a parable that Jesus gives. Matthew 22, when you're there, say amen. Amen. Verse 1 says, and Jesus answered and spake unto them again by parables and said, altogether, verse 1, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a certain king which made a marriage for his son. If you've studied this chapter before, perhaps if you haven't, we're going to look at it a little bit today to put it in context with our study. But this is an invitation to a wedding. A king forms a marriage for his son. And I will tell you that in Revelation 17, 14, those who stand with Christ during earth's final crisis accepts the invitation to a wedding, this wedding. This wedding. What are we invited to? Are we literally invited to a wedding is the question. Yes or no, saints?
Yes.
We are indeed. But that wedding is typical of something else. And that's what we want to understand, because those who stand with Christ realize that they were called to a wedding. Great Controversy 427. Great Controversy 427 says this. The proclamation, behold, listen closely, behold, the bridegroom cometh. Does that language sound familiar to you? Where is that from? Matthew 25. So Matthew 25 and Matthew 22 go hand in hand. The proclamation, behold, the bridegroom cometh, in the summer of 1844, led thousands to expect the immediate advent of the Lord. At the appointed time, the bridegroom came. Let me say, at the appointed time, the bridegroom, who is the bridegroom? Jesus. He came. Did the bridegroom come in 1844? Not to the earth, Surely we thought he was coming back to the earth to cleanse the earth by fire, correct? Let's go on and see if we can unpack this. The proclamation, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh, follow me now," in the summer of 1844 led thousands to expect the immediate advent of the Lord. At the appointed time, the bridegroom came, not to the earth as the people expected, but to the Ancient of Days in heaven, to the marriage, listen closely, the reception of his kingdom. Amen. Now, so what is implied by the marriage in Revelation, in Matthew chapter 22? It's the reception of what? His kingdom. His kingdom, yes. So the parable in Matthew 22 points to a time where Christ would take possession of his kingdom. Okay? Now, Daniel is going to give us... Go with me to Daniel chapter 7, because Daniel actually saw this take place. Revelation and Daniel are companion books, and we're studying the time of the end, and we just learned that that exact phrase, time of the end, comes from Daniel chapter 4, Daniel chapter 12, verse 4, and then again in verse 9. And we're told that the time of the end is not just something we say, it is a literal time period, beginning in 1798. And in 1798, knowledge of the prophecies began to become clear. And so now we can look back and understand these prophetic things. And Daniel, here in chapter 7, sees Christ receive his kingdom. So this is a future event here. We're looking at it now. Let's pick up in verse 9. Of course, Daniel is seeing the beast power that we call the Antichrist power. He's seeing them overcome the saints. And of course, this troubled him tremendously. But notice, we'll pick up on this experience in verse 9. If you're there, say amen, saints. Amen. I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like the pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. Who is Daniel seeing sit? This is the Father. This is the Father. Notice what it goes on to say. And a fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were open. What is Daniel catching a view of? The judgment. The judgment was set. That's why the Father sat. Notice what it goes on. We're going to jump down now to verse 13. I want you to notice what happened. Judgment scene, it says here in verse 13, I saw in the night visions. He was having a vision at night. It says, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven. What are the clouds of heaven? Angels. And came to the Ancient of Days, to the Father, and they brought him near before him. Judgment scene. We know, if we've looked at judgment before, this is a scene that happened in 1844. When you read the book Early Writings for my Adventist brethren that are watching, you will notice that Christ is in the holy place, and then the chariot pulls up. Christ gets up, gets into the chariot of angels, and they escort him into the most holy place before the Father. Amen. This is what Daniel sees. But I want you to notice, and this is the reason why we're looking at this verse, let's go on and look at the very last verse here. It says in verse 14, and there was what? Given. There was what? Given. At what time? During the time of the judgment, there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom. And a what, everyone? And a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. We're looking at what it means to be called during this final crisis. Now, you're probably wondering, Why is him receiving a kingdom connected to being called and a marriage? Right? What do the two have to do with each other? Let's go to Revelation, and there's one or two texts that will bring it all together. Okay? We're going to go to Revelation chapter 21. Revelation 21. So here we have, in Revelation chapter 21, again, now we're going back to John. Here a little, there a little, right? Line upon line, precept upon precept. That's how we gain an understanding of the Bible. So now we jump over to Revelation 21. And John sees something amazing. What does he see? Does anybody know what he sees coming down from heaven? He sees the New Jerusalem. Yes, he's looking up. The war is over. Now he sees the New Jerusalem descending from heaven. And notice the description, New Jerusalem, of New Jerusalem. It says in verse 2, "And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem," read it with me, "coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a what?" Come on, let's read it together. Prepared as a what? Bride adorned for her husband. So the New Jerusalem is likened, the reception of the kingdom is likened unto a wedding. Amen. Are we there? So now go with me to Matthew 22. Because if we go back now, we will understand that we are called to a wedding, and we are called to go where then to the wedding? Where's the wedding taking place, someone? Where in heaven? In the most holy place, because that's where Christ is right now. Because we just saw him be escorted into the presence of the Father, which is the most holy. So the wedding takes place where, everyone? Let me hear it. In the most holy place, in heaven, where Christ is. So it only makes sense then, when we now look at Matthew 22, that this is a call to prepare for judgment. The invitation to come is a call to prepare for judgment. It is a call to put your garments on. Amen. Amen. Are we there? For those of you that are just watching our service for the first time, we just 2 weeks ago studied a lesson called Getting Dressed for Heaven. And so this is really a continuation in some sorts of that message. And if you're joining us for the first time too, livingjustbyfaith.org, you can find the handout for that message, and you can also find all the resources for this as well. Continuing on, Father in heaven, pour out your spirit, we pray in Jesus' name. Give us understanding and enlightenment, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. So Matthew 22, you will notice that there's this call for God's people to come to the wedding. Now, it's only fitting then in verse 11. When you're there, say amen. Amen. We're going to read this together. And when the king came into, are we all together? Yeah. Okay, let's read it together. I like it when we all read it together. Okay, it makes the room sound nice. All right, you there? All right, verse 11, here we go. And when the king came in to see the guests, he saw there a man which had not on a wedding garment. Now, someone tell me what is happening here. What does verse 11 mean based on what we've studied already? What does it mean? What's happening here? It's judgment. And who comes in to see the guests? The king. Right? The king comes in to see the guests, and the wedding garment for this particular man is not on. Now, what's the wedding garment? Christ's righteousness. Okay, now, when does this take place, saints? When does this take place, saints? That's when it began. But when does it end? What is happening right now? The king is there doing what right now? Looking at the guests. Okay, now go with me over to Matthew 25. Let's add one other element. So you know that you've been called to the wedding, which is to get dressed for the judgment. Amen? Amen? You've all been called there. And this is what those who stand with Christ will realize, and they will actually get dressed for heaven. Amen. In Matthew chapter 25, we see it from a different angle. In one sense, we are told that as guests for the wedding, we are attending the wedding. In another sense, we are, in fact, the bride as well. So it's presented, the principles, don't let this confuse you. The principles are always the same, but God uses two different illustrations for a reason, and we're going to look at that. Matthew 25, are you there? Okay, here we go. Question and answer. I'm going to ask a question, you give me the answer. Who are the virgins in Matthew 25?
The church.
And particularly today, we're studying Revelation 17, 14. We're looking at that particular seventh church. So just any church? No, because this church claims to be a virgin, which a virgin in Scripture means that you are a woman, but you are a pure woman. Amen. Okay. And these virgins took their lamps. What are the lamps? The Word of God. So they had the Word of God. But they, in many ways, lacked something. What did they lack, everyone? The Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit was to illuminate the Word of God so that the Word of God can not only be here, but it could be here. Because the prophet of God tells us, if you've never looked at this before, that the oil is character. Because that's what God gives when He comes into your life. He gives you the character of love. Romans 5:5. Says the love of God is poured out in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. So when He comes, the oil, the Spirit, then you will have the character. So it's character that's not transferable. See, I can't give you my experience. You look at me and you say, man, why do I have to go through what I'm going through? God is actually trying to give you His character. When you have trials in your life and stumble around and you make mistakes, and hey, I always tell my children, you know what mistakes are? It becomes experience if you learn from it. If you learn from it. Amen. Amen. God is right now selling righteousness, and we are to buy it. And we've talked about, we talked about this a couple weeks ago, you buy it with your life. You give Christ your life with sin in it, and He gives you His life with righteousness in it. Amen. So we're breaking down Matthew 25 now. So we know that Christ is the bridegroom. Now, where is Christ in Matthew 25? Okay, let's look at it. It says here, while the bridegroom tarried. In verse 5, where is the bridegroom tarrying? In Matthew 25, verse 5. He's tarrying in heaven. Amen. And why is the bridegroom tarrying, saints? You say to test people's faith? Okay, we are told that in 1849, the prophet of God had a vision. And what did she see? She saw at that moment four angels had been dispatched. They were actually on their way to the gate of the city. They were leaving and they were pulling out their gold cards. And Jesus, who was before the Father, ministering before the Father as our high priest, looked and caught a glimpse of them leaving the city because they were going to do what? Release the winds of strife. Revelation chapter 7, you can read about this experience. And Jesus turned and said, my blood, my blood, my blood. He pled before the Father. Three times He said it. Three times. And then she says she saw another angel fly speedily to catch those angels that were leaving and to tell them in Revelation 7 to hold, hold, hold the four winds. And they've been being held until today, right? Amen. What that means then is, why is He tarrying? Because He looked and He saw that we were not ready. Amen. God's people were not ready. Not ready for what? They were not ready for Revelation chapter 17 to occur. You realize Revelation 17 is the crisis. You realize that it's too late to go to heaven to find forgiving grace in Revelation chapter 17. You have to be called, chosen, and faithful when that experience happens. And so God here in Matthew chapter 25, He tarries. And by the way, you do realize that we are not there in person at the wedding. I have talked to so many of my brethren and they say, I just hope I'm ready when Jesus comes in the clouds. No, 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 no. If you're not ready before Jesus comes in the clouds, you're not going to be ready when He comes. Let me give you some Bible for that. Go with me to Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12. Notice what it says. In fact, we must be there with Christ where? By faith. Notice, let's put the two together. And they that are what? With him. Come on, guys. Come on, saints. And they that are with him. With him where? There. In the most holy. They that are with him. If you're not in the most holy, you're still in the holy. If you're a Protestant, if you're a Christian, and if you're still in the holy, brothers and sisters, you haven't seen the sacredness of God's law and understood righteousness by faith or Christ our righteousness. They that are with him, we must be there by faith, there with him, in that room with him, before that law, before that mercy seat. He says, come boldly before the throne of grace. We have to go daily to that room with him. And here, look at what it says in Revelation, Luke chapter 12. Verse 35, we're going to read it together. Verse 35, are you there? Let's read it. Notice what it says in verse 35. Let your loins be girded about and your lights burning, and ye yourselves like unto men that wait for their Lord when he will return from the wedding, that when he cometh and does what? Knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. You don't have time to be getting ready when Jesus comes. You must be ready when he comes. And by the way, Jesus has come. Not literally, but Jesus already went to that most holy place. We have to wake up and it goes on to say, blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. What are you doing with these? Your daily task? Are you watching to prayer? Do you realize that right now Jesus is in that room for you? Right now he's there. This is what we're talking about. You see, the people of God, oftentimes we've been one step too late. We've been waiting, okay, well here, this is, no, now is the day of salvation. Seek the Lord while he may be found. He can be found while he's in that room. Now, we know this wedding takes place. Now, who gives the invitation? Who gives the invitation in Matthew chapter 22? His servants. In Matthew chapter 22, we give the invitation, yes or no? How do we know that we give the invitation? Because in Revelation chapter 14, we see those angels flying in the midst of heaven. And those angels are messengers. Those angels are called to give the message that will warn the world and announce that he's in the room. Have you told anyone that Jesus is in the room? You know, most people don't even know there is an ongoing judgment, but you do. Most people are waiting for some future experience to take place, but right now, we're living in that day. We give the invitation. We give the invitation through the gospel call. It's called the proclamation of the gospel. And how many are invited to this wedding? So all are, come on, say this with me, called. All are, so in Revelation 17, 14, all right. So the marriage occurs as, let me summarize, and then we're going to go to what it means to be chosen, okay? The marriage occurs as judgment, which is going on in heaven, passes to someone's name, and he is accepted and sealed. When Christ makes up his number, probation ends. Let me say that again. Right now, there's an ongoing judgment. We are told that right now, every person who has ever named the name of God, their names are coming up. If they're resting in the grave, their names have come up. He's looking at those names. Very soon, and we know not when, but we have been given a clue as to when judgment moves from the dead in Christ or out of Christ to the living. Does anybody know what that clue is? What is the sign that judgment passes from the dead to the living? Does anybody know? Sunday law. when the National Assembly law, and we're right here on the cusp of that, when that law comes into being, and for those of you that have never heard that term, we're told in the Bible, in the book of Revelation chapter 13, that soon there's going to be legislature that will be passed in our country, an amendment, she says, an amendment to the Constitution will be made that will enforce or that will restrict religious liberty. Meaning, and this is, and I hope you guys watch our docuseries, because our position this weekend was religious liberty. We wanted to do interviews on religious liberty with people, and most people don't understand religious liberty. Religious liberty is not me forcing you to do what I want you to do if it's Christ-like. No. I can't. Christ doesn't force. Amen? I can't force you to worship on a particular day or not worship on a particular day. You have what's called religious liberty. You can choose to love God and serve God, or you can choose not to. And true Adventism in religious liberty is fighting for to give people a right if they don't want to choose. And you say, well, how is that? That's what Jesus did. While you were yet sinners, Christ died for you. He died for you, gave his life for you, so you'd have the right to choose if you want to live with him. Is that not religious liberty? So I hope you get a chance to watch that. But here we are, when your name comes up in heaven, when it changes from the dead to the living, the Bible says that judgment begins at the house of God. So we're not looking at those out there. If you have named the name of God in the seventh church, in this remnant movement, then your name comes up first, and it starts with the leader. Oh, mercy, Pastor. Starts with us. It comes to us, and at that time, if we are settled in the truth, we are sealed with the seal. You know what happens in heaven at that very moment? What is blotted out? Not your name, but your sins are blotted out. This is what Peter meant when he says in Acts chapter 3, he says, when the time of refreshing comes, you must repent before the time of refreshing comes. Because at that moment, when your name comes up, you're either sealed with the seal of God or you're marked with the mark of the beast at that time. And if you're sealed with the seal of God, you receive the latter rain, brothers and sisters, and then you go forth to give that call. Amen. But if you're not sealed, then you're marked, and the Holy Spirit leaves forever. And at that point, we're told that you will never, ever again have mercy mixed with truth. It will be all truth and judgment, but no mercy. See, none of us know what it's like to live in a world with no mercy, because we've been under mercy since we were born. Amen. Because of Christ. And so that time is coming. So when your name comes up, you at that time must be ready. You must have on the garment at that time when Christ makes up his number. So we know that this wedding takes place. This is a summary in the New Jerusalem, or it takes place in heaven. Jesus then will, let me just show you this in the Bible. Go with me to Revelation chapter 19. Let's look at it real quickly, because the next two points are really quick. This is the one that we really needed to spend some time on so that we can have a foundation, particularly for the next. Revelation chapter 19. Notice what it says here. This is beautiful. Beginning in verse 7. When you're there, say amen with me. Let us, are you there? Let us all together. Is there a problem? Everything okay? Static? Okay. Just make sure everything else is on mute. Everything else is on mute. And make sure the mic with the cord, that's off. Okay. Father in heaven, Lord, please pour out your spirit. Help your people to really hear what is happening in this room, those who are not here. Lord, please, may you intervene, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're in Revelation chapter 19. Verse 7 says, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come. We talked about that. So now it's here. In this verse, it's here. And his wife hath made herself ready. She's ready. And to her, now, let's pay close attention. You know what it says? And to her, his wife, was granted that she should be arrayed in what? Fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. Now, do we understand that literally the bride of Christ, we've already looked at it being the city. But here, the bride of Christ is presented not only as the city of God, but is presented as his church. But the two principles are the same. Do you know why? Because we're told that in the city, that city is called a place where what dwells? Righteousness dwells. So the city, when she's fully adorned, will have saints with what? Righteousness. Notice what it says. It says, to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. Amen. When the saints populate the city is adorned. Jesus doesn't want an empty city. He wants his saints there. He wants his people there. And this is what it says. And to him, and he said unto me, right, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage, what? Now we've transitioned now. Not the marriage, but the marriage supper. What happens after a person gets married? They have a marriage supper. It's often called the banquet or the reception. Yes. So those who are invited to the wedding also participate in the supper. Now someone tell me, is this figure of speech or is this literal? Is it a figure of speech or is it literal? It's literal. Yes. What does Jesus say? Jesus told his disciples, he said, look, during the Last Supper, he said, I'm not going to eat or drink any more with you until when? Until I sit down with you in the kingdom and we do it anew. We are told, the prophet of God, that when we get to the kingdom, guess what Jesus is going to do? He's going to gird himself again. Amen. Just like he did in that room, but this time he's going to serve his disciples with food. And we're going to sit at that long banquet table. We're told that our eyes, it's miles long, but our eyes can stretch all the way over it. Oh, and we're going to eat, what, pomegranates and all types of fruit. Brother, you better start liking fruit today. Amen. Because God is going to feed us. He's going to serve us. That's the banquet. That's the banquet. We have to be called and receptive. Okay, now who are the chosen? Because I know you don't want to miss out. Does anybody want to miss out for that? Do you know why anyone would miss out? Can I just show you this one scripture that shows why people would miss out? Look at Luke 22. Luke 14. Only reason why anybody would miss out. Only reason. Luke, and you'll understand it why specifically when I go to the next verse. When you can say amen. Another parable that's connected to the marriage. And it says in verse 16, Luke 14, 16, then he said unto him, a certain man made a great supper and bade many a supper now, and sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden, come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make what? Whenever you make an excuse for not sitting at the feet of Jesus daily, whenever you make an excuse that you don't have time for worship, whenever you make an excuse you don't have time to pray for other people, it's an excuse. There is not one single excuse for sin. There's not an excuse. The only reason why anyone would make an excuse to not do these things or not spend time with Christ in this way is because they see the value of the thing more than they see the value of this experience we're talking about today. That's what it is. When things in your life that you look at become exalted, they will blind you to Christ. You can't see the joy of what we're talking about. And there's hope in that too, because 2 Corinthians chapter 3:18 tells us, if you just leave your tent, go out there with your poison, that serpent, and you just would have patience enough to just look at Jesus, that looking experience will change you. I read a quote to you 2 weeks ago that you know how you let the word of God dwell richly in you? Just look. And as you look, something supernatural happens in your life. You just look. I don't care how you feel about looking, just look. I don't care if you want to do it, just look. If you just look every day, you can say what you want to do. I don't want to do it. I don't want to do it. I do. Just look. What does the song say? And the things of this earth will grow what? Strangely dim. You don't even know why you're doing what you're doing anymore. Just look. God has made a provision for you. Who are the chosen? So kletos, called elekos, chosen. What does that mean? It means picked out, chosen by God, and it's a term that applies only to those who respond to the gospel call. Do you understand? When you respond, so you're called, but you must be willing to respond to the gospel call. It describes the gospel call of all to the wedding, provides a description of the chosen. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 1 really quickly and look at it. You will say, all have been called. Well, I'm going to show you. Ephesians chapter 1, when you get there, say amen. One of the highlights of this study, this verse here in Ephesians chapter 1, we're going to begin reading in verse 3. How are we doing on that static thing? Did God take care of it? It's gone? Okay, praise the Lord. Verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he hath what, everyone? Chosen us where? Okay, now, where were we chosen? When were we chosen? Whoa. Woo, hold on. So we've been called. Now we're being called because the gospel call began to go out, right? It's began to go. But are you saying that we've been chosen too? So hold on. We need to switch that then, because we were chosen and then we've been called. And don't you know that's exactly what Paul says? Let's go to Timothy, 2 Timothy. This in all the Bible as it relates to the gospel. God chose you. You are not just someone. You are not just right here in this time period. You are not just born on this planet. You could have been created on any other planet in God's marvelous solar system, in God's galaxy, in God's universe, but he chose you. And the reason why I know he chose you is because he says, before I formed you in the womb, I what? So God doesn't create things and then have, God has a plan for everything he creates. You are supposed to be on this planet during this crisis hour. You were supposed to be here. Don't ever forget that. Amen. Notice what it says here in beginning in 2 Timothy chapter 1, beginning in verse 9. Let's look at verse 8. Be not thou his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God. Be a partaker of those afflictions. Why? Because he hath what? Saved us and called us with a holy calling. God saved you. Now, when did God save you? When he chose you. Because he chose you, he saved you. Because he chose you, he saved you. Amen. God saved you, and now he is calling you out. That marvel. To walk. To walk in the works created for you before the foundation of the world. Walk in those works. Yes, you've been called because you've been chosen. And those who stand with Christ that are in that room realize that. They realize that they're not just some afterthought. They're not just trying to earn something. No, God saved you. He chose you already. And you know what? We're told throughout the Bible it's because of his purpose and his grace that he chose you. You know what the purpose is? Why did he choose you? Let's go. Let's look at that real quick, and then we'll wrap up. Let's go back to Ephesians. It's right there in Ephesians. I remember when I first saw this, and I thought, wow, Lord, little me? Yes, little you. If you just know who you are, if you will accept and embrace who you are, if you would just recognize what God wants to do with you and in you, and through you. It's bigger than this planet, I would tell you that. Not to any old world did Christ come. Not to any other world did Christ become one of us. We're talking about the King of the universe here. Not to any other creation will he be forever identified throughout the endless ages of eternity. No, no, no. He's identified with you. He gave himself to you. You have entered into a union with him. You have married him, husband and wife, forever throughout eternity. That's why he lives with you. And that's why you live with him. You don't live with a woman before you get married, do you? But when you marry that woman comes and lives with you. And guess what? Jesus is inviting you to come and live with him. In fact, he came and created a new home right where you used to live. And now he's saying, come live with me. Let's live together forever. Your husband and wife together. Ephesians 1. We see in verse 4 in Ephesians 1, according as he hath chosen for the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. And that's not the reason why he chose us. He wanted that for us. But remember, have you read the quote in Desire of Ages that says that the plan of salvation wasn't about me? Anybody else read that? Show of hands. That the plan of salvation actually had a deeper purpose than the salvation of man. Did you know that? Did you know that? It had a deeper purpose than you. Now, we are part of that purpose, obviously. A big part of that purpose. It's bigger than you think it is, because here it is. The train of progression, beginning in verse 4, is Paul explains, and then he gets all the way to verse 7 in that altogether. That in the ages to come. So hold on, let's stop. So when? And it's not this world, that's the next world. So why? Ages to come, when you're in heaven, when you are standing in his righteousness, that you are perfect in Jesus Christ. He says that in the ages to come, he might do what? Show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Jesus. What is on display when you are flying around in the midst of heaven? God's character, his grace, his mercy, his love, his compassion, his everywhere you go, they'll say, God's good because of you being there. So God saved us and then he calls us. And our purpose and grace, we have to fulfill that purpose that God gave us before the world was. We need to be strong in that grace. And you know what the only term of acceptance is? There's only one term of acceptance. It's that garment. That's all it is. It's putting on that garment, that righteous character, which is righteousness is, and love is the life and light of God. It's that love, putting it on, just being willing to say, Lord, and by the way, taking it, appropriating it. So you're called, you're chosen, and then will you be faithful is the question. Will you be faithful? That word, G4103, is pistos. And it means, no, first of all, it's used a number of different ways, but the way it's used in Revelation 17, 14, well, first of all, what are some ways it's used? It means a person who's faithful to duty or business or transaction, one who keeps his faith or remains loyal, one that can be relied on. But it doesn't mean any of those in Revelation 17, 14. You know what it means? It means one who trusts in God's promises. See, that word faithful is not self-centered. It's not, see, I did it. It's God did it. God fulfilled his promise in my life. God made me what he said he was going to make me. God did. I just literally believed. Righteousness by what, everyone? Why will sin not rise a second time? Someone tell me. Because God fulfilled his promise in me. It's not because my choice is removed, is it? It's because I will have exercised faith in that promise. You see, it's always reciprocal. You give me what you have, and I give you what I have. What do you have to exercise? Faith. And that's what Christ did for you. We must learn then, in order to be identified with this group and to stand with this group, here it is. In closing, we must learn to trust in God's promises. And I will tell you that God can be trusted. God can be trusted. What must you learn to trust in? His promises. 5 Testimony 53. Notice your hand. I want to point to two of them. I have a handout here for those of you watching online. You can just contact us. We'll be happy to email this to you. Call chosen faithful. Look at that top quote there. You want to know what this last term really means. Those, are you watching together? Are we all there? Yes. Those together, those who would rather die than perform a wrong act are the only ones who will be found faithful. Mercy. Christ is our example, brethren. Saints, stop taking sin lightly. Amen. Would rather do what? Die than perform a wrong act. What if the wrong act is just a little one? Are you at a point now where you would rather die? Christ is the example. How do we know? Well, here we are, Christ in the garden. And he's there. And here it is. If I go through with it, he couldn't see through the portals of the tomb. I might not ever see my father again. He would have rather died eternally than disobeyed his father. Amen. Feelings didn't matter. Feelings had nothing to do with it. He did not want to die. You can say what you want to. Christ did not want to die because death, Isaiah 59, creates separation. Sin creates death, and death creates separation between the Father and Son. Amen. Amen. He did not want to. He would rather have died eternally than disobey, though. And that's the faithfulness that God promises to give you. It's not, I will get there one day. God, do this in me. God said he would do it in you. Blessed are those who are what? What does it say in Revelation 14:12? They keep the commandments of God and they have the faith of? The faith of Jesus is a faith that would die rather than disobey the Father. And he promises today to give that to you. You believe that promise. Notice what it says, that very last one, the very last quote. Wait to feel that. Do not wait to feel that you are made whole. How many of you are living on faith or feeling today? You are basing your relationship with Christ on what you feel like today. Brothers and sisters, you can never appropriate the righteousness of Christ by doing that. His word. What does it say, saints? Believe his word, amid it will be fulfilled. Put your will on the side of Christ. That's your choice. Will, choose to serve him. I don't want to do it, but I'm doing it anyway. Amen. And acting upon his word, you will receive what? Strength. Whatever may be the evil practice, the master passion, which through long indulgence binds both soul and body, Christ is able and longs to do what? To deliver. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Are you going to be among my appeal? Are you going to be amongst the faithful? Because you know what that means? It simply means that you're with him. Where is Christ? He's in that room. I invite you to join Christ in that room. And you know how you go? We're told in Hebrews, you enter by faith. Now, God doesn't ask you to delay going into that room with him. No, you don't deserve to be there. None of you do. You never will. No, you never will. Yet you still, he says, do something boldly that you've been running from all your life, all sheepish because of sin and guilt and fear and bondage. But you know, in this room is where you find grace, enabling grace. You got to come right into that room. And it's vulnerable sometimes because you know who you are. And I don't know who you are, but you know when you're not here, what you do and what you think about, you know what goes on in that room. And sometimes you run from that room over there. But I will tell you that you must go into that realm with Christ. You must enter there, because if you enter, you are already called and you've been chosen in Christ. And when you accept that, that's when you're chosen. But you have to accept that. You have to embrace the call before you can be identified with the chosen. It's like, I've given you something already. Right, Raquel? But unless you take it from me, it's yours, but you don't have possession of it. Amen. Take possession of the promises, brothers and sisters. Will you bow your heads as we pray? Noah, Father in heaven, these trials, and just, Lord, you just impress me that, brothers and sisters, listen, do you realize that the final crisis it's not about if you're afraid to die or if you're worried about someone chopping your head off. That's not the final crisis. The final crisis is when you, in your mind, reason with God and you wonder if you've confessed every sin, if you left something undone in this life. And if you feel that you have left something undone, your faith will fail. When Aaron was in the most holy place, do you realize every sin needed to go before into the most holy place? Send those sins up. Tell God whatever is in your heart, whatever is wrong, whatever you don't want to do, you do want to do. Be honest with God. No matter what position you are in, no matter how old you're in, tell him about it every day. He cannot get weary of hearing it. Just don't settle for your condition. Don't make Christ. Esther, have a seat. Esther, have a seat. Don't make Christ accept what he will never accept. Amen. Don't make him do it. Father in heaven, thank you so much for your word. It's true. It's true. And we must come in line with it, not make it change. Your word forever, it's settled in heaven. May it be settled in us. May we be settled in thee. May we cease to practice unbelief is what we need, Lord. May we cease to doubt, cease to question. Give us and fulfill that promise in us. We give you permission. We believe it's possible. Fulfill that promise in us. We're not making any promises to you because we can't keep it. Our promises are like ropes of sand. But we believe, help our unbelief, that you are going to bring us to a point, you're going to do it, where we would rather die than commit one wrong act. And that's when we can be identified with this group who stand through the crisis. And you said, every man who hath this hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. May it be so, Lord, as Mary said to the angel, as thou sayest. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Time for tithe and offering. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 7 says, today, if ye will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. I want to read a little excerpt from Councils on Stewardship. Too late. It will not be long before probation will close. If you do not now serve the Lord with fidelity, how will you meet the record of your unfaithful dealing? Not long hence, a call will be made for a settlement of accounts, and you will be asked, how much owest thou unto my Lord? If you have refused to deal honestly with God, I beseech you to think of your deficiency and, if possible, to make restitution. If this cannot be done in humble penitence, pray that God, for Christ's sake, will pardon your great debt. Begin now to act like Christians. Make no excuse for failing to give to the Lord his own. Now, while mercy's sweet voice is still heard, While it is not yet too late for wrongs to be righted, while it is called today, if ye will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. If you will come forward as we pray. Father God, we thank you for calling us, for choosing us even before the call. Lord, we ask for faithfulness. It doesn't come from within us, it's from you. Help us to receive it. It's a free gift. In our giving, help us to recall who it is that calls us and what he's done to ensure that we're faithful. You've done everything for us. Bless our giving. May it serve purposes even beyond what we understand. May it go to further your cause in mighty ways, we pray. In your precious name, amen. Please stand for our closing hymn, When We All Get to Heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a while we walk the pilgrim's pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all prepare.